Chicago?
Brutalism.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, it's not about the competition. That was like in the Lynch book, like what was the word, what do you want?
Brutalism?
I could have thought of it.
Good idea.
Yeah. Let it trickle down to us.
One never knows.
One never knows.
It was pretty close vote, though.
Yeah. Happy video.
I already made that. But it's never.
Next one's trying to jump in.
Our country. Need my top setting?
Not right this minute.
But we'll need it later.
Maybe. I don't know how many questions you ask. Oh, no, just saying, you may or may not need your laptop, but not right now.
Oh, okay.
Not until a little later.
See, Karen, I should be here questioning.
You can keep the laptop out.
Okay, I don't have a problem with the laptop.
Okay, it is officially 8 o'clock, so let's go ahead and get started. So today's topic is what? Corporate real estate.
Yeah.
Okay?
What?
What?
What'd you think?
Corporate real estate. did you look at the syllabus at all, Winston?
I show up and listen, man.
Okay, corporate real estate. So if you took a look at all at the reading for today, one of the things that it talks about, which is, and it's a question of how they came up with this number, but their claim is that 75%, and you're not being tested over this, so I don't have to write that number down, but 75% of all commercial real estate is corporate owned, okay? Now, what are the implications of that? And what does it really mean, and why do we really care about that, okay? Because we're saying, well, okay, if 75% is corporate owned, and the other 25% is somehow maybe individually owned or owned by some other kind of organization, maybe nonprofits or government or whatever else it might be. But what does it matter if real estate is corporate owned? And what other options would corporations have in terms of using or occupying real estate? Well, the big one is the whole, should they own the real estate or should they lease it, okay? And so you could have a corporation that owns the real estate, but then another corporation that leases the real estate from that particular corporation. And so the thing that I want you to sort of kind of, I guess, think about a little bit is, let's say you're a restaurant chain or you're a drugstore chain, or you know, some other retailer that may need, you know, a lot of different buildings across the country or across the world for that matter. And are you better off pursuing a strategy of where you're gonna go, you're gonna buy the land, you're gonna build your building, and you know, build to your specifications, and then ultimately own and occupy it for the next, you know, 25, 30 years, versus working out some sort of an arrangement where you end up leasing those buildings for the next 25 or 30 years. So just what are your thoughts? I mean, as to whether you should pursue one approach or the other. I mean, what are some of the things that you should be thinking about with respect to that?
I think on the type of business that you're in.
Okay, I mean.
For example, like a drugstore.
Okay.
Like Walgreens is on every corner. So,
I mean, are you saying that they should own and occupy their own buildings, or are you saying that they should lease them, and why?
That's a lot of real estate.
It is, it's a lot of real estate to own and manage, no question about it.
So what happens if the competition comes in and they don't have a need for a Walgreens on every corner?
Okay.
And they own all this real estate.
That's a very good question, and obviously, in terms of retailers today that own a lot of real estate, that very problem has happened to Sears. Okay, we'll talk a little bit about that in a minute. Okay, so other issues with regard to the sort of the corporate ownership aspect. Other issues or problems or opportunities? I'm sorry?
Your cash strapped.
That's a big one. Because
cash strapped.
Cash strapped. In other words, you've spent, and it was kind of what you're sort of saying as well, the whole thing that, I mean, it's sort of like you as an individual, you've got a choice of, okay, I'm going to go buy a house, live in that house, or I'm going to go maybe rent a house or an apartment or whatever it might be. Which one is the bigger financial obligation? Buy. Okay. Which one do you possibly get some tax advantages from? Buy. Which one do you have, you know, not only a bigger financial obligation, but potentially a bigger financial return from owning, okay, or buying. But which one is the shorter term obligation in terms of, you know, if, for example, you lose your job or potentially change careers or need to move or that sort of thing, which one's going to be easier?
Renting.
Absolutely. Okay, now put that in the context of a corporation. You know, a lot of those same kind of thought processes, you know, exist there as well. That, you know, you've got to begin to say, well, you know, which one is maybe more appropriate, you know, for them for whatever reasons. I mean, you know, the whole thing of potentially, you know, do we go and we build and own and occupy all of these structures, you know, once again, across the globe for our particular business? And, you know, while that could be a great play for us, it does tie up an awful lot of our financial wherewithal, you know, that we could be using that money for something else. You know, greater expansion possibly, or research and development, or, you know, something else. And we've got another problem with all that real estate that we hold on our books, and this will be to see if my assumption is that San Miguel in the accounting class should have probably talked a little bit at some point, maybe if not yet, hopefully at some point in the near future, about how is real estate held on the books. In other words, whenever you initially purchase it, what is recorded? In other words, what value is recorded? The purchase price. Okay? And over time, does that purchase price inherently just automatically get updated on the on your balance sheet? No. So what problem does that potentially cause at some point in the future? In other words, if you acquire, you're like Sears, let's say, you know, Sears and Roebuck, they acquired many of those properties that they own currently back in the 1950s, the 1960s, the 1970s, and maybe to a certain extent in the 1980s, whenever they were super popular. Everybody was shopped at Sears. How many of you, you know, I don't want to embarrass anybody, but how many of you have shopped at Sears within the past 5 years? Okay, one or two people. Okay, but you know, if you'd asked that question 20 or 30 years ago, virtually everybody's hand would have probably gone up. Okay, nothing wrong with that, but it's an interesting evolution that particular retailer is no longer the obviously predominant retailer for whatever reasons. Okay, but the point is, they own all this real estate that's been on their books for years and years that they acquired at really low, relative to today's standards, low prices. Chances are, there's a lot of hidden value, if you will, with respect to that real estate being on their books. And they're not the first company that has experienced this. We went through this whole thing back in the 1980s with Safeway grocery stores, where they owned a bunch of their real estate that they had acquired in the 1930s and the 40s and the 50s, and then they were no longer the predominant grocery store chain, and all of a sudden they had all this hidden value. And ultimately, one of the things that began to sort of take place with companies like them were, you've heard of the term that became very popular in the 1980s, you know, hostile takeovers or corporate takeovers or, you know, leverage buyouts and that sort of thing. Well, most of those, believe it or not, were driven by the real estate values. Because you had these companies that for the most part were worth more dead than they were alive. Okay? Because their business, whatever business they were in, had kind of declined. It was no longer all that profitable for whatever reasons, that, you know, they just were no longer competitive within their particular segment of the market. But they all had all this real estate that potentially was worth, you know, millions, if not billions of dollars, just sitting there underutilized. Okay? So, you know, of course, the simple, you know, question would be, well, why don't you just sell it off? Well, in some cases, they did do just that. And then did what we've now termed the whole sale leaseback, of where you basically, you owned the real estate, but now you've said, okay, we need to get this stuff off our books. We need to get some cash in our hands. So let's sell it all off to a third-party investor. We initiate a 25, 30-year lease at a rate that we effectively set, and that frees up a ton of cash flow for us today. But, you know, a lot of companies chose not to do that. They chose to continue to own the real estate. And as a result, you know, they are, you know, in these situations of where they're effectively, you know, they're maybe asset rich, but sort of the business itself is not doing all that great. Well, my point with that is, you know, in addition to why don't they just sell it off, that it poses another problem. I mean, well, what are they supposed to do? Okay, I guess what I'm trying to get around to is, all right, assume they sell off the real estate and they even, you know, and maybe don't engage in a sale leaseback. Well, that means they've got to shut down that store or shut down that location and potentially move to an alternative location somewhere else that they're going to obviously have probably a higher cost basis to probably get into. So it's kind of like, this is kind of, it's an interesting thing that it's sort of a catch-22. They've got all this value that's locked up in this real estate, but unless they really shut down operations, they're not going to be able to realize that value. Does that make sense? You know, to a certain extent, I mean, putting it in a totally different context, and like a nonprofit context, I mean, think about like churches. You know, you may have these massive churches that maybe were built 100, 200 years ago, beautiful Gothic structures that may be sitting on some of the most prime real estate in the middle of the city and you know across the world, but chances are those churches aren't going to be selling off that prime real estate unless their church effectively goes out of business. You know, the same, you know, general concept. But the interesting thing about these corporations that own all this real estate, fundamentally, what should they be doing? In your minds, I mean, you know, sort of removing all of the, you know, restrictions for a moment, if you've got a situation of where you owned, as a corporation, a lot of real estate, and your company really was worth more dead meaning you sell off all the real estate, you close down operations, and you quit the business, so to speak, versus continuing to limp along in an industry where apparently you're no longer really competitive for whatever reasons. I mean, what would you do? Or, Winston?
Start selling some of those off.
Yeah, you probably would start paring down, you know, some of those assets and start closing stores and that sort of thing. But what else might you consider?
Why not look for some partners, some savvy partners that's aware of what's going on in today's market that can utilize my space? Person may say, oh, I'm dead now. I'm gonna sell off all my assets.
And that's absolutely great in theory, but in practice, you know, there's probably a lot of entrenched sort of people within those organizations that are, you know, stuck doing things the way they've always done them and are resistant to change. And, you know, it just makes it, you know, just that much more of a gargantuan sort of task.
They'd rather die than die.
Yeah, or they're just you know, it's sort of like they also have a choice.
But that's exactly what happened to Sears, like you said, because I read an article, they said that And from a shareholder point of view, they should have, what if they were just liquidated all
yeah.
the assets?
Yeah, no, they would have been much better off. Shareholders would have been much better off.
Right.
You know, but then, you know, you have the whole other angle, which is, you know, the people angle.
Right.
You know, think about all those people you're putting out of work. But at the same time, would those people maybe be better off going to work for someone else, one of the competitors that's left within the industry, as opposed to continuing to work for an organization that's clearly just on the downhill slide? And then what do you end up doing for your shareholders? Well, effectively, the shares become worthless at some point because you've just literally milked every dollar out of whatever value might have been present. Thoughts on that?
No, I was gonna continue on about thoughts about what to do. I would probably try to like analyze the portfolio and try to sell off the ones that are that have weaker markets that don't have any opportunity for reuse or
mm-hmm.
repurposing, and then concentrate on those markets which I have the property in that we can obviously reuse and repurpose. And then that way, then when you sell off half of it, you have enough cash on hand for your shareholders, so you can probably over time regain those losses.
And that's the approach that many of these corporations take. And sometimes it works. Sometimes, you know, that model works. In other cases, it's already on the downhill. You're just selling off assets to plow into, once again, a business that really is not going to be ripe for a turnaround.
Mm-hmm. No, I'm not saying you stay, keep with the same business. Like, if you have this building, then now
you're saying repurpose it completely.
Repurpose it completely.
All right. So you're literally saying, all right, sell off some of the peripheral assets that aren't in great markets,
right?
And let's shut down the actual business itself.
Right.
Okay. Get out of that business. Get rid of the Sears name. Get rid of all of that, and let's start from scratch with kind of a new concept within
right.
the stronger markets.
Yeah,
okay.
Right.
Sure.
The board will never allow it.
Yeah.
They can just change. That's the problem. Is they can just become real estate developers at some point. They have so much real estate. They just say, you know what? We'll shut down Sears, and we'll manage your properties and rent them out.
But
that's not
going to
happen.
Like, that's what I was meaning by looking for savvy partners in the market. Because, I mean, it's no use just dying off when you can do other things with the real estate. The real estate still has value. Maybe
right.
Sears is dead, but the real estate still has value.
No, and I would agree. It absolutely it does. And we're talking about some other potential strategies. Okay, Kyle?
Well, I think, like, the Sears example, like, I feel like one of the problems they've had is the only real estate they really owned was just their, store and everything like that. Like, if you look at, like, Publix and what they're doing now where they're buying
shopping centers.
Yeah, they're buying entire shopping centers. I think if back, 20, 30 years ago, Sears would have been much better off if they had looked at the bigger picture and said, okay, well, instead of just purchasing this store for us,
right.
let's purchase the entire shopping mall.
Yeah, because by purchasing maybe the entire shopping center, you have more control
yeah.
over the other tenants that are going to be placed in there and the overall sort of upkeep, maintenance, and that sort of thing maybe associated with it. So I think, yeah, that's probably not
and
a bad strategy.
You're not worrying about like selling off all your assets because, maybe one shopping mall's not doing well, but more than likely you're going to have some shopping malls that are still doing well and you're still getting that rent roll every year.
Yep.
So.
Okay.
Well,
all right.
I would assume that they would create, instead of Sears proper owning it, have an affiliated, sister corporation holding company that, that basically leases it back to them, but
yes.
they have control, so they're not
yes.
dealing with 100 different sellers.
Yep. No, and that has also been a strategy that a lot of these companies have employed, is to basically create a spinoff company that is purely their real estate holdings. And so that, you're sort of keeping some sort of a Chinese firewall between, the two. And so that, hopefully there's some sort of an arm's length, kind of transaction that, exists there. I mean, another great example on a massive scale were railroad companies. Okay, a lot of people don't realize this, but railroads were some of the biggest first developers in the U.S., across the U.S., because what had happened, a lot of you may or may not realize this, but whenever the rail lines were being built, along the rail lines, the U.S. government, as part of kind of the incentive to the railroad companies to effectively construct the railroads, is that they would give, the federal government would give them the 100 acres on alternating sides of the rail lines pretty much all along the entire railroad. Meaning, the railroad would own this 100 acres, and then the government or whoever would sell this off to other sort of private sector, you know, individuals. Well, you think about this, that made railroad companies, and some of them still own hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of thousands of acres of real estate. Now, some of it in the middle of the desert, but, you know, they own a lot of real estate. And they spun off, and many of them spun off probably 20, 30 years ago, a lot of those real estate holdings and became, you know, developers in their own right of, you know, those parcels of land that they owned that they had acquired literally more than 100 years ago, okay? And so, you know, the idea, you know, of this, you know, kind of needing this kind of separation, if you will, between kind of an operating business and real estate is not new. It's just, it muddies the waters, you know, because how do you go about separating, like a hotel is a prime example, you know, how do you go about separating the business value of the actual operating business of the hotel from the real estate value, the land value, the actual bricks and sticks value? You know, it's a real challenge to try to separate the two, okay? And, you know, the same sort of thing, you know, applies to many of these other types of uses. It's just that with retail centers, it's a little bit easier to repurpose those for alternative retailers than it is to repurpose a hotel for some other alternative use, okay? Yes, sir.
You have mortgages on all the properties and any cash infusion? I mean, you don't have to.
Yeah, you can refinance.
Just refinance.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, and that's assuming that you did pay cash for them up front. In many cases, you may have received mortgages on those properties, or you may have used alternative means of corporate financing, which would have been you issuing stock or issuing bonds under the corporate name to actually fund those real estate assets. Like, for example, if you're a publicly traded corporation, you know, you've got two pretty much easy access forms of capital. You can either issue shares of stock to, you know, obviously the general population, all right, or you can issue bonds, which are a form of debt, obviously, to that same group. Now, the difference between the two is that with bonds, there's a fixed rate of return that typically is attached to those, much like a mortgage, okay? But you're going directly to the investors as opposed to having to go through a third party with regard to the, in terms of going through a traditional lender to actually obtain a mortgage loan on a particular asset. The point being is, as a corporation, you can just simply issue these bonds, this debt, and then you as the corporation get to figure out, how do I want to spend this money? You know, do I want to spend it on buying buildings? Do I want to spend it on equipment? Do I want to spend it on, you know, something else? Okay? And so, my point in bringing that up is each of those sources of capital are going to have a different cost. Okay? Historically, your cheapest cost of financing would have been to issue bonds. Your second cheapest source would have been to get probably the more traditional mortgage loan. And then the more expensive would have been to issue stock. Things have swirled around quite a bit within recent years to where now those first two may be, in some cases, flip-flopped. That it might actually be cheaper to get a mortgage loan than it is to issue corporate debt. But the point being is, part of what, you know, I'm trying to get you to sort of think through is, you may very well end up going to work in a real estate department at the corporation that owns or has to manage, you know, a wide variety of locations, you know, throughout the world. And you have to begin to think about, how might we go about financing these? You know, should we, you know, potentially refinance everything at a much lower cost of capital? Because if we're able to do that, then that's going to help to inflate our rates of return not only those assets, but on the corporation as a whole. Because those can be, obviously, once again, very serious dollars that we're actually talking about in that respect. Okay. Any thoughts on that? Nope. Okay. So, in terms of any kind of advantages for the corporation to own the real estate versus leasing the real estate from a third party, ideas?
Tax benefits for the depreciation.
Okay, if you own it, you're going to get the mortgage interest deduction, and you're going to get the depreciation deduction if you own it. Whereas if you lease it, you get to write off typically the full lease payment. Now, in some cases, it may actually be that full lease payment is a higher number than the mortgage interest deduction and the depreciation deduction. And so you might actually be at an advantage from a tax perspective of being able to write off that full amount. And so this is where, you know, once again, some of the analysis that we're going to begin to sort of look at, you know, it's not an absolute as to which one is the better strategy, is what I'm trying to say. You know, it depends on the unique circumstances of that particular corporation, that particular investor, as to whether or not it's going to be better off leasing the property or potentially owning the property. Now, one of the things that I mentioned earlier was the idea of a sale leaseback. I may have talked about this a little bit before, but let's explore it. Okay. For a single leaseback, we take something like someone mentioned like a Walgreens or a CVS or some other sort of big box kind of retailer. And so they go out, you know, find their parcel of land, you know, build their building, you know, put in their parking and everything, go ahead and outfit the store completely. And so, you know, let's just say that their cost of land is $1 million. Right? And then the cost of construction is $7 million for the building and the finishing out the parking, doing everything that needs to be done for the whole construction process. So overall investment that they've made of $8 million in this deal. Okay, very simple scenario. Now, they say, once we've made this investment of this $8 million in this parcel, we have built it out to our specifications, then we decide we're going to market this in the private sector and potentially find a private sector buyer. In many cases, it's going to be some sort of either an institutional investor, it's going to be a wealthy individual, but they're going to work out an arrangement whereby they can sell that $8 million asset for, let's say, $10 million. Okay? So the point is, with this particular arrangement, and this is, you know, like, once again, they're controlling the whole upfront development process. They're going through, they're doing everything, and the idea is that, yeah, they're able to sell it for $10 million, take that $2 million as a capital gain, as profit upon the sale of the asset, and then engage in some sort of a long-term lease. Well, typically, you know, for this sort of a scenario, it might be that the lease is going to be predicated on this $10 million. If you want to sort of think of it in these terms, think of from the perspective of you have purchased this building from Walgreens, CVS for $10 million, so the Griffins now own this, all right? They've paid effectively cash for it, but now, assuming that I'm Walgreens, I'm gonna engage with you for a 25-year lease, okay? And your perspective is, you know that you spent your $10 million and engage in this 25-year lease. Now, the question that you've got to sort of ask is, well, what sort of rate of return do you require, you know, as investors, realizing that I'm a high-quality tenant, you know, in this property, I built the property, and this lease is going to be an absolute triple net lease, meaning you're not going to have any management responsibilities whatsoever on this property. All you're going to do is you're going to open up your mailbox once a month and you're going to get a nice check, okay? That's literally all you have to do for the next 25 years, okay? And so you said, all right, a 5% rate of return is good enough for us because, once again, we don't have to do anything, all right? And so based on that, you're going to get, you're going to get a monthly check of $58,459.00 for the next 25 years, okay? Now, from Walgreens or CVS's perspective, what has happened, okay? From their perspective, from my perspective as Walgreens CVS, you know, I initially had to spend $1 million on my land, spent $7 million on this construction, so I have an $8 million investment. So I'm walking away with $10 million cash money that I then am able to take that $2 million profit and potentially do a wide variety of things with it. I could either reinvest it in another store or use it to potentially pay my rent or pay the lease payment for several months, or use it just for operations of getting the store up and running for, you know, many months. So I mean, there's a lot of different ways that, you know, that money potentially could be used. But the point, you know, is it's an interesting model because it allows them to set the terms of basically the lease agreement with you. But they're shopping this thing around and they're already pre-negotiating, you know, what that interest rate that they're going to be basically providing to you as a return. All of that's going to be pre-established. And so, in other words, from their perspective, from Walgreens' perspective, all of this is known. So it's not like you're going to have a landlord that's going to all of a sudden raise your rent or change the terms of the agreement. Everything is sort of locked in stone for, now granted, we could have escalation clauses built in there and that sort of thing if we choose to, but that is not a requirement, is my point. Let's see.
So as the investor in the relationship, what are you go to run your numbers the same compared to whatever you're receiving? If I'm receiving X percentage in the bank or in some kind of high yield account,
it's really
maybe the 50 grand.
It's basically you're comparing, you've got a 5% rate of return. And once again, if you're a high net worth individual that potentially, you're just looking for a safe place to park your cash, you know, this could be a pretty safe place to park your cash. And then you're just simply getting those payments, you know, every month. And then you can choose to do with whatever those payments, you know, you may be living off of those payments. You may be using those payments to plow into some other alternative investment. But the point is simply you're going to get that fixed. It's like a coupon payment of $58,000 a month for the next 25 years. Jason, question? Okay. Okay. In that case, you still have the asset of the building that you would then be able to sell, hopefully for something close to the $10 million or more. You know, or, you know, release it. Or, you know, potentially, you know, if the company actually does go out of business and you're not able to collect, I mean, hopefully you collect something, you know, in some sort of a bankruptcy or, you know, foreclosure, you know, whatever it might be. But you actually own the asset, so it's not an issue you're really foreclosing. It's just whenever they stop paying you effectively rent, the eviction aspect of getting rid of them as a tenant quicker or sooner rather than later. Yep.
But wouldn't if Walgreens, I don't know, or whatever the company goes out of business, doesn't the property go dark then? but you still collect rent? They're still required to.
If the company is still able to make the payments, or they're still required to make them, even though the building may be dark,
right,
technically they're still required to make payments.
Right.
But if there's no cash for them to be able to make those payments with, you know, then obviously you may have a property that you're, I mean, it, once again, it's dark, it's not collecting rent, but at some point, if you pretty much realize you're not going to be getting any more money out of them, then you're going to want to either sell that property or put it up for lease, or do whatever you know, might need to do to remedy the situation.
But they said that's one of the strategies for getting out of leases going bankrupt.
Right, and I am not a bankruptcy expert. You know, once again, that might be another good San Miguel kind of question.
Right.
Okay,
okay.
I have another question.
Yep.
If, let's say they don't go bankrupt, but you know how cities shift and this is a good area right now,
right,
but 10 years, 15
right,
years down the line, it's a blighted area.
Right.
And their business is not
producing
in that area. Is there a way for them to get out of that?
In some cases, no. In some cases, they're wedded to that thing, you know, pretty much regardless. Because, I mean, if you think about it, I mean, it's a little bit different than them just going in and saying, okay, we're going to lease your building for X number of years. In this case, they were the ones that built the building. They were the ones that selected the location. So there's inherently a bit more of a tangible kind of investment / relationship that what they're probably going to have to do is they're going to have to simply say, we're going to have to take potentially revenues from one of our other locations and subsidize potentially this location and just kind of ride out the storm, so to speak, which is not uncommon. Okay. Other questions?
Is there anything built into the lease that says that they have to keep the property? You know, you would think they would want to keep the property up because it's their business, but I've seen.
Yeah, no, and there would be, but at the same time, you know, it all depends on the inherent provisions of their lease. There's no one standard commercial lease. You know, unlike at the residential level where you've got all these different apartment associations and things that, and the promulgated forms for, you know, I mean, there is, yes, maybe somewhat of a promulgated form for commercial, but that's not usually what gets used. Most of the time, it is a lease specifically written for them with potentially hundreds of pages of details describing those very situations. What if this happens? What if that happens? How do we deal with, you know, this issue or that issue? And so, in many cases, yeah, those issues are going to be covered. Okay. Other questions?
Well, this is probably a great question. Like real estate with no recourse, once you get the property value not awarded, hey, there's a loophole that if your operational expenses, you can't service the debt, get back the lease.
Right, get back the property. Well, and then once again, that depends. I mean, and you know, in this sort of a situation, chances are it's not really going to be a non-recourse situation. You're going to have to probably pledge the full faith and credit of the corporation to that lease. So it's not going to be one that you're going to be probably able to just walk away from, is my point. Okay? Anything else? Yep.
Yes. Who would establish the 5% interest?
It would be a negotiation. I mean, chances are what would actually happen is that Walgreens, CVS, whatever, would say, okay, we've got this location, and they would market it through someone like Marcus Millichap or whoever and sort of say, we've got this triple net leased property that is available at this price point with this particular sort of you know, lease that would be put into place upon purchase, and basically see what the offers are. Now, chances are what they would probably do is they would start marketing it with maybe a lower, you know, basically rate of return to the prospective.
So it would be a bid process.
Yeah.
Got it.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Anybody else? Stephen, you're really quiet today. What the heck?
Wrong week.
Okay. All right. So, all right, let's move on then to some of the other issues here. So here's some of the things that we were going to talk a little bit about in terms of the corporate real estate aspects. All right. So in terms of having corporate real estate, all these are in the book. Okay. Don't take pictures of them and run them all down. But in terms of why do corporations own real estate? Okay. The first one, very simply put, they own the space that's using their core business. So this is what we were talking about earlier. That once again, you've got a retailer, you've got a restaurant, you've got, you know, for that matter, could even be, you know, we haven't really even talked about the office side of things, that you've got a large corporate campus, you know, that maybe, you know, you're a, whether it's a technology firm or insurance company or whoever, and maybe you've created this massive, you know, sort of campus that you own and you occupy. Well, yet again, another reason for you now to potentially be the owner of that property is one of the things that we talked about previously on the sustainability side of things, that you may want to own and operate your own property simply because you may have more control up front in terms of what kind of air conditioning systems that you might put in terms of operational efficiencies that you might put into place. If you own and you operate your own facility, you would want to do what? Make it potentially to be as efficient as possible from an operational point of view, whereas you might not be so inclined to do so if it is a situation of where you don't own it and you're simply leasing it and you're the developer that actually builds this property. You might not have as much of an incentive to make it as efficient as it possibly could be. Okay. The second one listed here, investing for diversification. So this is the sort of thing that, once again, as a corporation, that you may be in the restaurant business or you may be in some other type of business. And maybe, like, to use the restaurant example as an example. You buy a property, you realize you need 5 acres, let's say for your restaurant, all inclusive of the parking and everything else affiliated with it, but yet you buy 20 acres of land, you know. And so it kind of gets almost to the what Kyle mentioned about Publix, you know, the idea that you might very well end up buying more land to be able to potentially either sell off or potentially serve as your own sort of developer for the project around you. Okay? You know, the same sort of thing that, once again, as a residential home builder, you might choose to buy, you know, hundreds of acres of land, but you only need maybe 70% of that for your actual residential subdivision. You know, the other 25-30%, you're able to potentially then create retail, office, other sort of mixed use kind of properties on that surplus land. So the idea of being able to diversify your portfolio beyond whatever your core business is might be yet another reason for owning the real estate. This next one is also kind of interesting, retaining rather than selling real estate that was used previously. So, you know, this is the whole thing of where you maybe did need this real estate for a number of years for whatever purpose in your core business, and then instead of selling it off, you continue to own it and maybe reposition it into something else altogether that would allow you to maybe, once again, be able to generate a much higher rate of return than being continually employed in the core business, whatever that might be, okay? And then finally, acquiring additional real estate for future business expansion or relocation. This one is a key, I mean, once again, you look at something like Publix, I can keep using them as an example. Most grocery store chains, many of them, will actually acquire sites many, many, many years prior to them actually needing them, especially in areas that they feel are going to be, you know, growth corridors. If they want to acquire the land at a really low bargain basement price, that's usually a necessity. And so, certainly in Texas, many of the grocery store chains there would literally acquire these parcels of land almost out in the middle of nowhere, you know, and hold them for 10, 15, 20 years because, you know, these were going to be sites that they knew that at some point would be of value to them for one reason or another. Okay, so big one to sort of think of. Now, speaking of and just kind of thinking through just for a moment, that strategy of kind of, you know, I mean, the typical real estate investment strategy is the buy low, sell high, okay? I mean, it's a pretty simple strategy. And one of the things that was sort of going through my mind, and obviously Claudius, you know, will point to you, but, you know, the whole Brickell City, you know, center redevelopment, you know, there in downtown Miami, you know, that area that the Brickell City Center is, you know, being developed on, my understanding was that the folks, whenever Spire acquired that property, you know, back in 2006, 7, 8, somewhere in that vicinity, the market value of that property was about $125 million or
suppressed.
The market value at the peak was about $125 million or so. Their ultimate or subsequent purchase price of the property was about $44 million. Okay? Meaning that, you know, if they had acquired that property for the original price of the $125 million, let's say, or 111, whatever the number was, you know, almost three times what they actually acquired it at, they would not have been able to do what they have done with the property, is kind of my point.
Right.
You know, because that allowed a lot of flexibility and freedom in terms of the kind of project they were able to create, the density they were able to create, the different multitude of uses that they were able to integrate. They had a lot of wiggle room in terms of you know, from a corporate, you know, sort of developed, you know, kind of project, that it allowed them, you know, a lot of flexibility. Okay, moving forward. All right, so the whole thing of leasing versus owning, these are some of them. Let's just sort of, you know, we've talked a little bit about some of these, but the deductibility of the full lease payment, flexibility, your equity is not inherently tied up on the leasing side, limited maintenance responsibilities on maybe the leasing side, reduced balance sheet liability. So all of those I think we have talked about in some extent or another. Okay, any questions about any of those?
Well, you say limited maintenance. I thought it would be a triple net.
Well, okay, depends, okay? You know, if it is an absolute triple net, then yes, you're gonna have limited maintenance. But it may very well be that you only have just a net lease, or you could potentially have a gross lease where all things are gonna be responsible by the landlord. So it just sort of depends on the circumstances of the lease as to, like for example, replacement of the roof, replacement of parking lot, replacement of, you know, air conditioners and things like that. Those aren't normally going to be the responsibility of the tenant, except under maybe something like an absolute triple net lease. Okay? All right, on the owning side, benefits, building up of equity, okay, on the project, in the sense that, you know, over time as you're making those payments, hopefully you're building up equity in the project so that at some point you own it free and clear. A big one is potentially, you know, what is the reversion value of the property at some point in the future in terms of, you know, if you're able to sell the property, what are you potentially going to be able to get for it? And as we've already mentioned, deduction of the interest expense, appreciation expense. But as we mentioned also, you have the ability to potentially, you know, sell the business, keep the real estate. I think that's actually one of the things that Quincy brought up. And then also, as you brought up, the whole thing of refinancing in order to fund other operations that you might have. Okay, so I think we've pretty well covered most of those. Okay, any others you want to add to the list?
Tax implications.
Yeah, the tax implications, you know, could be very favorable for you for, you know, owning. But also, there could be, on the leasing side, the tax deductibility of your full lease payment is also something to have to consider. So those are going to be the trade-offs, okay?
Under owning, you could also repurpose.
Yes, you could.
What we were doing to the case study of Professor San Miguel, when he was looking at the 10K, the companies the builders that was purchasing land, they was leasing during the lease option versus the buy, so they could free up their cash. And the only thing they could lose is basically their deposit.
Mm-hmm.
So that was a good strategy.
Yeah, no, I mean, there are many, many different ways to structure these kind of, you know, arrangements. It's just, you know, and all of them have different motivations. You know, but in many instances it is. You know, to what extent can we free up cash to be able to do other things? Okay, a couple of things to as I sort of mentioned, the residual value or reversion value. This one may or may not be relevant if it's a situation of it's corporate owned and it's always going to be used by the corporation. Kind of, you know, once again, that mindset that you are Sears, you're going to continue to operate as a Sears forever and ever is kind of the mindset whenever maybe they buy these properties. And so the idea of there really, you know, being a reversion value or being a residual value is not something that maybe they're even thinking of, because they're thinking of it as what is the usefulness of this property, you know, as we own it. Okay, and so the point being is a lot of analysts will sort of say, well, that's irrelevant unless you shut down the corporation, you shut down the business, then you're able to maybe extract that value. But that goes back to what I said in the phrase that I used. The company is worth more dead than it is alive. Okay. Now, this next one is kind of interesting in terms of the corporate or credit rating of the corporation. Because this has a lot to do with how they may be able to finance the real estate, okay? And as I mentioned earlier, the whole idea of either issuing corporate bonds, issuing stock, or getting a mortgage on the property. Now, if you get a mortgage on the property, what are you doing? You're basically saying, you know, what's backing the mortgage? Well, for the most part, it's the real estate and the performance of that real estate, okay? And but yet, if you're buying it as a corporation, think about this for a moment. Well, what is the bank really basing the credit on?
Your ability to pay it.
Your ability to pay it as a corporation. So it's not really being based on it's not really being based on like what are the prevailing lease rates? Because you're just owner occupying it. You know, so not really. Now they may try to do some sort of a backdoor kind of analysis as a lender to sort of get, you know, well, under the worst case scenario, if we had to potentially evict, you know, this corporation from this space because they're unable to meet their debt obligations, then what could this be leased for and leased at? You know, that's a whole other, you know, sort of way of looking at it. Which is also part of the reason why many, many corporations don't inherently get traditional mortgages. That they choose to roll it all up into corporate issue debt so that it's not inherently attached to a specific asset. Does that make sense? When you're getting debt on the company as a whole, it's kind of like you going and getting a line of credit. Okay, but it's much easier for a corporation to do that. I mean, you can go get maybe a 10, 15, you know, $50,000, maybe $100,000 line of credit, just back purely on your, you know, abilities to repay that money. But corporations, you know, obviously have a much deeper back pocket to be able to pull from, and so their ability to go get that sort of line of credit is much easier, okay? And so as such, I mean, you could theoretically use your line of credit to do what? Go buy real estate. Now, chances are, with only a $10,000 or $20,000 line of credit, you're probably not going to buy much real estate. But a corporation, if they have a much larger sort of line of credit, they can potentially go and get, you know, several millions of dollars or hundreds of millions of dollars of real estate and potentially develop that and all owned under the corporate umbrella. Okay? Any questions? Okay. Well, that leads us into weighted average cost of capital for the corporation. Now, any of you that have any sort of backgrounds whatsoever in traditional corporate finance, you probably have heard of weighted average cost of capital. How many of you have heard, any of you have ever heard the concept, weighted average cost of capital? Okay, two or three of you, all right? And was that as part of this program or somewhere else? Okay, undergrad. Okay, yep. And what about you, Victor?
Yeah, I think it was capital markets.
Okay, yeah, it's very possible. No, it should have been talked about to some extent in capital markets. Okay, so weighted average cost of capital. What this is, you as a corporation much the same as you as an individual, have multiple sources of where you get your money from, okay? You as an individual, where does your money come from, okay? Your money can come from a salary, your money can come from investments that you've made, your money can come from getting debt in terms of borrowing money from a bank or from someone else. So the money or could come from savings or whatever it might be, okay? From a corporate point of view, there are two primary sources of capital, even though you can break those out into many different layers, but two primary sources of capital, debt and equity, okay? Debt is what I'm sort of describing, our mortgages, our bonds, okay? And you're going to have to pay interest that's usually at a fixed rate of return on that debt. And then you don't worry about what's up there for the moment, okay? Then on the other side, you have equity, okay? Which is the money that the corporation has raised from investors that they then have to give some sort of a rate of return back to those investors that, you know, they don't inherently usually guarantee a specific rate of return. There might be something sort of implied, but for the most part, it's a bit more kind of, well, if we are successful, here is maybe the kind of the rate of return that we can offer, but it's not really as guaranteed as what the debt is usually. Okay, does that make sense? All right, now, in terms of the formula, it looks a lot worse than what it really is. So let's go down to actually a few pages. So a little that far. Okay. So basically, your weighted average cost of capital as a corporation, you've got two primary components. Over here is the debt. Over here is the equity. Okay? And under the debt, you're basically on this side, you're going to have what really is just the loan-to-value ratio. It's probably the easiest way to sort of think of it. Or it's the percentage of your capital structure or capital stack, as you may have heard it, that is debt. Does that make sense? So like in a typical real estate investment, you know, this might be an 80% loan-to-value ratio, okay? Well, if you have borrowed or you have used 80% debt to fund operations within your company, what does that mean your equity has to be?
20%.
Thank God. Okay. Got that.
Well, they gave it.
All right. Well, I just want to make sure, you know, a little worry sometimes. Okay, so 20% is going to be your equity, okay? Now, your cost of debt is going to be your interest rate, okay? And in this simple model, we're looking at this on a before-tax basis, and we're also sort of making the assumption that this is kind of an interest-only sort of loan, all right? So our cost of debt, give me a number. This is just going to be an interest rate on the debt.
4%.
4%, as per Winston. Okay? Now, what was that, Quincy? Oh, okay. All right. So, in terms of our return on equity or our cost of equity, however we want to sort of couch it, this is going to be the, for whatever investment it is we're doing as a corporate, whether it's, once again, we're investing in real estate, whether we're investing in the company as a whole, this is sort of the return that we are supposedly wanting to give to our shareholders. Okay? So, give me a number there, Winston. You're the number man.
5.5%.
No, much higher than that.
Wow.
12.
Probably, yeah, at least I would have gone 15. But
15.
But
that's cool. 15.
Pretty good number.
I would have given my investors a much higher rate of return, Winston.
Yeah, right. You know, be realistic.
Okay, so with this, the simple way to approach it is just to kind of, you know, split these into two different little simple calculations.
What's that last thing called?
It's going to be either your return on equity or your cost of equity, same thing. Okay, so this first piece on the debt side, all you're gonna do is take 0.8 times 0.04, and that's gonna give us 0.032, okay? On the equity side, 0.2 times 0.15 gives us 0.03. So if we add those two together, we should get 0.062 or 6.2%. Okay, does that make sense, everybody? Yes or no? Okay, so what that means is that for this company, that their cost of capital, their weighted average cost of capital on a before tax basis, is 6.2%. Okay, is everybody cool with that?
And now, is there like a range where it's good or
bad? No, not really. I mean, it's relative.
Okay.
You know, depending on what the current market conditions are, so that one corporation, you know, might have a much lower cost of capital than another corporation. And it depends on what industry you're in as well. That, for example, if you're in a high risk, sort of potentially high return kind of industry, you know, like a technology sort of industry, then chances are that cost of equity is going to be astronomical, okay? And because it's also high risk, high return, chances are, unless you've got some really tangible assets, your cost of debt's also going to be pretty high because the lenders or the bondholders are going to be saying, well, what do we really have to attach to? I mean, what are the really physical assets of some sort of a technology company that when I say technology, I'm thinking more like internet sort of kind of technology company where there maybe aren't really any physical assets. So that number's going to be dramatically higher. Then might be the case with like a utility company where the utility company, that's all you have for pretty much hard assets. You've got a power plant, you've got distribution lines, you've got income from the people that are obviously tying into that utility. All of that is very fixed, all of that's very stable, all of that's very predictable, and so chances are your cost of capital is gonna be dramatically lower as a utility company than it would be for like a technology company, kind of using two sort of extremes. Does that make sense? Okay, so, but within an industry, you know, you would also sort of take, that's why you would, normally you do an industry analysis and sort of say, okay, within our particular industry, how do we fare on these things, okay? Other questions? Okay, so, if this is our before tax weighted average cost of capital, how do we get an after tax weighted average cost of capital? Multiply by not just your tax rate, but by 1 minus the tax rate.
Yeah.
Okay? So the after tax weighted average cost of capital is equal to the before tax weighted average cost of capital times 1 minus the tax rate. Okay? So if I were to tell you tax rate equals 28%, then you should be able to tell me what is my after-tax weighted average cost of capital. Okay, so how would you do that? Okay, if my before-tax weighted average cost of capital is 6.2%, that's going to be multiplied by 1 minus 28%, or if we want to, for putting it in the calculator, 0.062 times 0.72, point, 04464 or 4.464%. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Okay, now why is this number relevant to us?
Because we have to pay taxes.
Because we have to pay taxes, and we obviously we want to know to make it comparable, once again, to other types of investment alternatives that may be available to us, and to be able to compare things like if we are leasing versus owning, we're probably going to want to do an after-tax sort of analysis for us as a corporation to say, what is my true after-tax cost of leasing? What is my true after-tax cost of effectively owning the property? And we're going to get into those calculations here in just a second, okay? But all of this makes sense. Yes, no, possibly could be. Okay, yep.
I'm not understanding why when you add into the tax burden, how your cost of capital is less than the before tax.
We don't know, because you're getting the deductibility of the interest.
Okay, gotcha.
Okay. Okay, now, let's do this. Let's see what we got. 904. Okay, one of the things. Between a financial lease and an operating lease. Did Sam Miguel cover this?
One is capital and one is operational lease.
Okay, well, a capital lease is also just another term for financial lease.
It's how it's shown on your balance sheet.
Okay, so let's talk about that just for a second. Okay, so this one, as we said, is also known as a capital lease. One is shown on your balance sheet, one traditionally is not. Which one is, which one's not?
The capital is shown as long-term liability.
Yep.
Operating shown as
a short-term obligation.
Right.
Okay. Now, why do we care about that?
Because it doesn't accurately show the future or the liability that your lease is over the long term.
Okay.
One can be depreciated, the other one can be expensed.
Exactly. That's one issue, okay? And so, historically, back before all of the accounting reforms that took place with the Sarbanes-Oxley, I'm sure you guys talked about that a little bit, you had the situation of where you had a number of corporations that were purposely structuring their leases as operating leases, when in reality, they were financial leases or capital leases, and so what they were trying to do is, it's like this, you have to kind of make sure that I paint the picture correctly. It's kind of like what I was saying earlier in terms of the financial obligations that you would have as kind of an individual. I think all of us would agree that your financial obligation to do a year-long residential lease on an apartment is different than potentially obviously trying to own that asset, obviously, you know, where you've got a mortgage for the next 30 years, okay? But with the financial lease, to a certain extent, it is a long-term obligation. It is an obligation that you do have for many years into the future, and therefore, it should be treated effectively as some form of debt, okay? Or some form of liability would be the right vernacular to use. And as such, it is, because of that, it is placing a burden, financial burden, on your company that may preclude you from getting additional financing for someone else or for something else. It also could be a situation of where that you you could be trying to hide what sort of financial obligations that you might have, okay? And what I mean by that is, and I'm, without getting into all of the excruciatingly painful detail, but I'm sure he kind of, probably, did he talk about synthetic leases at all?
No.
Okay. All right, so one of the things, here's the way to think about this. This is kind of, it's kind of an interesting concept. We got a lot of people in trouble, so it doesn't really exist in its current form anymore. But you would have, let's say, a parent corporation. I use that term purposely. Oops, corp. Okay, and then you would have a subsidiary. Number one, and maybe subsidiary number two. And so what would happen is the parent corp would be pretty much the full owner of these two subsidiaries, okay? And these subsidiaries would act on their own behalf, okay, with their own sort of corporate structure, okay? So in other words, they were their own sort of corporations, but they rolled up into the parent corp, okay? So they would go out and they would get a loan, let's say, on a piece of real estate, or buy it.
The subsidiary.
They would go and they would, so let's say that Quincy is a subsidiary, all right? He goes out, he buys this piece of real estate, this warehouse, manufacturing facility, whatever it might be. You buy it, you get the loan on it. But whenever he goes to try to get the financing for that purchase, what credit is going to be used to get that? In other words,
the parent company.
So what ends up happening is then this relationship begins to exist. He's the owner. And then effectively, maybe the parent corp might be using this, or this subsidiary might actually be leasing this property from the subsidiary. But the interesting part is that the parent corp would be effectively the one co-signing the loan in some form or fashion, indirectly. But the thing is, the co-signing didn't inherently show up on the financial statements. Think of it like this. And the reason I use the parent is, imagine you've got kids, okay? You're the parent, they're the subsidiaries, okay? They go out, they buy a house. You in turn tell them, okay, it's your first house, we're gonna help you out with the down payment, we're gonna help you out with co-signing the loan, so since you don't have, or you haven't established credit yet, we're gonna co-sign for this. Well, as a general rule, historically, in many cases, those co-signing events may not have shown up on the parent's credit report. Mm-hmm. Okay? And so that parent, let's say that that parent had 20 kids. The parent could go co-signing on all these deals. And as long as everybody's paying, everything's okay. But all of a sudden, if one of the kids stops paying, and the kid doesn't have any money, who's going to be held responsible?
The parent.
So that's basically using the piggyback technique for the credit.
Right, but the point being is, they were purposely, and in terms of the corporations, were structuring it this way so that it would look as if they didn't have any real financial liability or obligations. Right. All of those financial obligations were really being separately housed within these subsidiaries. Does that make sense? Okay, and because of the lack of transparency with regard to a lot of the financial statements, this was being hidden from view.
Isn't that what Enron did?
That's precisely what Enron did. And it was through this combination of what were termed synthetic leases. Okay, what is the word? Remove the word lease. What is synthetic?
Artificial.
Yeah.
Okay, so that explains precisely what was going on. It was a lease, but not really a lease, you know. And so as such, it was a big sham that it really was set up purposely to not be honest, forthright, you know, on the part of the parent corp, they were purposely trying to hide what was really going on, you know, down here, and to try to look as though they were much more financially solvent and much more
debt free
than what they really were. Okay, Kyle.
But wouldn't that show up at the bit, like?
It does now. Well, it didn't then. That's the point. The laws have been changed to reflect that. You know, it was an accounting stroke of magic and genius. Whenever, you know, when I say that, I mean that I am not
loophole.
Let me make sure it was a loophole. Okay, let me put it that way. And it was stroke of genius in the sense that people really put this much thought into trying to circumnavigate, you know, this sort of situation, and it was perfectly okay, you know, for them to do this. It wasn't okay. It was legal for them to do this. It was not ethical for them to do this.
Right, right.
That's probably the right word.
Can't you still do that on a non-GAAP funding?
And that is once again another good question for San Miguel. Okay, in terms of the devil in the details of what you can and cannot still do. My point is just simply, you know, be aware of, you know, this sort of a situation and why we would care whether or not it was, because what was really happening here is by virtue of this sort of structure, the parent corp was able to make it appear as though this is an operating lease, when in reality it was maybe really a financial lease.
Well, this old gap and non-gap is on the scrutiny now.
Okay. Any questions on any of that up to this point? Okay. All right, let's do this. Let's change gears. I know you're getting a little tired of that stuff. I can tell by Stephen's eyes. So let's move on and move to some spreadsheet stuff here for a second.
Computers.
All right.
What's the implication? This might be the same as the other question. But what's the implications on the investment community with people leaving the EU? Why
is
the
dollar
drop so
good? What? Uncertainty. It's a simple answer.
Yeah, but were they that important to the global economy?
Yeah, well, yeah.
It's like Russia folded as a company.
But it's the uncertainty that gets created by something like that. It's because we don't know what all of the implications are. We don't know what all the fallout is really going to be. And so the usual thing is for everyone to overreact. And then once everything kind of gets sorted out bit by bit, little by little, then everything begins to kind of return to somewhat to normal. But it's all the uncertainty that's got everybody spooked as to what, you know, specifically is going to happen, because we don't really know. And chances are, it's really not going to be that big of a deal at the end of the day. I say that big of a deal, I mean, to the average ordinary person. It's going to be a huge, massive deal, and has already been a huge, massive deal to the major, big-time financial power brokers. You know, those folks, yeah, it's going to, I mean, like yesterday, I think something like $156 billion worth of paper losses for, you know, some of these folks. Well, okay, that's not inherently you and me. Okay, but you know, those folks that are betting on much bigger, grander schemes of globalization, you know, then it's probably not a great thing for them.
Plus, I think long term, because of the trade pacts that are in place,
it's a good day to buy.
Yeah, well, and then you've also got, you know, obviously additional countries are threatening to leave. I think France is one of them that's probably saying that we're going to, I think Hungary and a couple of others.
Scotland,
maybe, I don't know. But, yeah. Well, I mean, they're going to be separate. They're currently part of the UK.
They want
UK.
To leave the country. They want their own.
Well, yeah. No, they want to leave. Yes, they want to leave the UK, potentially. Because if you look at the voting pattern, not that you want to get an offer for this,
right.
But if you look at the voting pattern, it was like all of Scotland was saying, you know, we want to stay with the EU. But now, with that having happened, then there may be the case where they want to.
Is they tried to separate before. Now they have pause to go after that again.
So it's not just the scope of this class.
Huh?
I thought that was the scope of this class.
No, that's the
no, that's
legal. The legal professor's
Sinestra.
Is that outside of scope.
And I guess the fact that we'll ask questions that are way up.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
So if you have to, there's 61.
Okay. Did I send you this one, Excel templates?
No.
Okay. All right. Well, I'm going to send that to you. Let me do this instead. Let's just do this instead. All right.
You're not setting it up?
I can't get connected. It won't allow me to connect to the network for whatever reason.
You're going to do the guest.
Yeah, you control the guest.
Yes.
I've never had a problem with connecting before, but all of a sudden now I do.
Oh, yeah.
If you use the NSC1, just use your login.
Well, it won't even allow me to, that's what I'm saying. Oh. It's not even allowing me to connect at all.
You want to sign into your thing and send the email?
There it is.
Yeah, you're on. Okay, good.
Oh.
There we go. Okay. Okay, let's take a 5-minute break while I get this thing set up. Okay, it has been sent.
That one problem on a quiz a couple weeks ago, first question you had on there was about, when I asked you, you're like, it's in the book.
Red Bull, Steve?
Sorry.
Red Bull.
Might be one.
Pull up this spreadsheet on your laptop. It's the one I sent you, and in the event it doesn't pull up directly to this one, this is the one you want to go to, which down here on the bottom, you should have all these little tabs, and so you're going to the one that's chapter 15, lease versus own. What I figured I would do is sort of take a look at kind of what this spreadsheet is doing, and then go through on our own some of the mechanics of the calculations, but to kind of show you at least some of the different things are being taken into consideration and kind of simplify it, okay? All right, so this particular spreadsheet, now all these spreadsheets I just sent you are the ones that basically accompany the textbook, okay? So you should be able to actually even go to the for the textbook website and get all of these, but they were pretty much organized by chapter and then, you know, a lot of different, you know, sort of things that they will do. But this one is specifically looking at the whole lease versus own sort of analysis. And basically what you're doing is you sort of take a look, and the numbers that you may have should match up with the ones I've got here, but so you've got information about the company, about the lease, about the tax considerations, and about the ownership information, all right? And so each of these little yellow cells is pretty much an input cell, And so all you're going to be doing is just kind of modifying these, and then everything down below will basically repopulate or populate. So let's just sort of start out kind of here at the top and explain what each of these variables are. Most of them you probably can figure out pretty quickly on your own. But these first few are probably going to seem a bit out of place, okay? In the sense that you're saying, well, okay, sales revenue, cost of goods sold, additional overhead, upfront opening cost, what the heck are we talking about? Okay. This is the thing that hopefully this will make this all make sense. In this analysis, what we are doing is we're making the assumption we are a company. And as this company, we are looking at what our sales revenues are for the company. So we're, in this case, we're not looking at rental rates, is the point. Because if this is corporate-owned real estate, we really don't have rent, per se. Does that make sense? So what we're really looking at is, well, what is our cost of running our business and occupying and you know, the lease versus the own aspect of the real estate. So it's a different mindset is what I guess I'm trying to say. Thus is why you have a couple of additional pieces of information here. So the sales revenue is just simply saying, okay, you as a company have $1 million of sales over the course of the year. Your cost of goods sold, this is just simply saying whatever product it is that you're selling, 25% of that is what the actual cost is. Like if you're selling golf balls, just to use some random thing out of the air. You're selling golf balls, the price that you pay for those golf balls, or the price that you sell those golf balls at, versus what you're actually, your cost of acquiring those golf balls is, you're basically, if you're selling the golf ball for a dollar, 25% or 25 cents is what it's costing you. Does that make sense? That's what the cost of goods sold is. Additional overhead, this is just a dollar amount. This could be salaries, this could be, you know, virtually anything. And then upfront operating or opening cost, this is going to be like finish out cost, if you will, or, you know, for actually occupying your building or your space. Also could be, you know, equipment, could be a, you know, wide variety of things, okay?
It's not getting... CIs and equipment.
Exactly, okay? All right. Then on the lease, we simply are saying, okay, we've got an annual payment on the lease. We chose to sort of express it that way simply because it's a commercial lease. And normally whenever we talk about commercial leases, we talk about what is the annual lease dollar amount, okay? Usually per square foot, but in this case, our annual payment, $35,000. Lease terms over 15 years, and then operating expenses. So one of the things that you do get to deduct both as an owner as well as the lessee are your operating expenses. So in other words, your utility bills and whatever else may be present with the property, you're going to deduct those. We're simply going to say, in this case, those are going to be 15% of your annual payment, okay, are your operating expenses. Then as far as tax considerations here, the corporate tax rate that we have selected is 15%, and then the depreciable life and the number of years we have set to 39 years. Now, one of the examples is given in your book, if you actually use your book, okay, the depreciable life.